This press conference. I'm sorry we're running a little bit behind schedule, but we're just about to start. But before we introduce the prize committee of the Mo Ibrahim Foundation, we'd like to play you a short film which sets out the Foundation's vision. So if we could just have 5 more minutes of your time, the film will start now. Thank you very much.
Nothing is as important as ensuring the quality of governance and good leadership in Africa. An African leader is faced with major challenges. How to take his people out of poverty, how to deal with issues of educating many young people, sorting out conflicts, dealing with health issues, water, electricity. Their success is crucial. It's crucial for the lives of millions of people in Africa.
We need a leadership that will create a bond between those who lead and the people who have given their trust in elections.
Leadership is important everywhere, but especially so in Africa. The tasks facing leaders in Africa are challenging, and the lives and well-beings of many millions of people depend upon the performance of those leaders. It follows that we should strive to recognize and reward those successful leaders who are able to deliver tangible results for their citizens.
Our African continent is rich in the diversity of its people. It is rich in its resources, and it is rich in its potential. Our continent is beginning to fulfill this promise.
I am Mo Ibrahim. I am a Nubian from Sudan, so I am an African. I am a businessman who was involved in building telecom infrastructure in Africa through Celtel, which is a success story. I think we prove the point that people can do clean business in Africa, help create jobs, create prosperity, build infrastructure, and also can be profitable.
Good governance and democracy are central to Africa's development. Without them, it will be hard, if not impossible, for any African countries to reach the Millennium Development Goals by 2015. That is why the mission of the Mo Ibrahim Foundation is so important. Thanks to Mo's vision, the foundation can contribute to the growing movement to build honest and enlightened African leadership.
Mo Ibrahim has established the Mo Ibrahim Foundation to develop criteria for good governance, stimulate a public debate, and challenge the continent's leaders to set the global benchmark on this issue.
We really want to support the African leadership, and we want to reward achievement. We want to celebrate success of African leadership. We are going to offer the largest prize in history, the largest prize in the world, for those successful leaders who manage really to take these people forward. Nothing is more important than that. And the important thing here is that we are African, and this is an African foundation. It's an African money. This is Africa doing its own business. It's time for us to really look back into Africa and do something ourselves. We cannot just sit there and expect the world to come and do things for us. And so it is in that context we are launching really our foundation.
It's wonderful that somebody of the caliber of Mo Ibrahim, a successful businessman, feels so strongly about Africa and about leadership in Africa.
I wish the foundation much success in its important work. And I thank Mo Ibrahim for the leadership that he is demonstrating, the prize for which will be one we can all share, a better and brighter future.
May your initiative inspire and celebrate the best of African leadership and equip future leaders with the knowledge and experience they will need.
مرحبا بكم في مكتبة اسكندرية. Bienvenue à la bibliothèque d'Alexandrie. Welcome to the Library of Alexandria. My name is Ismail Siragiddin, the director of the Library of Alexandria, and it is a great, great, great honor for me today to welcome this very distinguished group. Mr. Mohammed Ibrahim, Mo Ibrahim to his friends, founder of the Mo Ibrahim Prize, and of course, Secretary General Kofi Annan, Chairman of the Prize Committee, Secretary General Salim Ahmed Salim, President Mary Robinson, Aisha, President Atisari, Mrs. Gozi Okonjo-Iweala, all of them very distinguished people whom you know from the material with you. Without further ado, I leave this podium and simply ask you to join me in welcoming this enormously distinguished group.
Assalamu alaikum, marhab bikum. I'm delighted to welcome you to Alexandria, to the library. On the day of the first ever ceremony of the Ibrahim Prize. Today is the day of celebration. We are here to honor our first winner, the former president of Mozambique, Joaquim Chissano. I'm thrilled that we're having our first party here in Alexandria, a city that I know very well. I have been educated here, I grew up here, and it's a particular delight to be here in this splendid, wonderful new library, which recreates the splendor of the Library of Alexandria over 2,000 years ago. Alexandria gave the world its greatest ever and first library. That's an important contribution to civilization. And let me now tell you a little bit about the prize. It's intended to celebrate the African leadership and to be a catalyst for good governance. It's supported by the index, which the foundation produces, which is a vital tool to help assess progress and empower people across the African nation. It's a valuable tool we are giving the civil society to have an informed discussion with their governments. In our early years, the foundation has decided to focus on sub-Saharan countries because they face a unique set of challenges. So we are evaluating at the moment 48 countries. Our first winner will speak this evening, and you'll have the chance to hear him. I believe he's also having a press conference tomorrow, so you'll have the opportunity also to talk to him again. But I'm delighted to be joined now by another great African, a man who led the United Nations, and a man who played a vital role, really, in steering and chairing our prize committee. And I don't know if you're aware, but tonight also we're going to have a wonderful performances from Youssou N'Dour, and there'll be also video contributions from Nelson Mandela and Bill Clinton. We're in tight schedule, so I hope we'll really be precise and quick. And I turn really to our great brother, Kofi. Give him the platform.
Thank you very much, Mo. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you don't mind if I do it from here. I think with my gray hair, I've earned the right to sit. Let me say that for me it was a great honor to chair the prize committee. And as you can see, I had wonderful colleagues and friends working with me, and I want to thank them and Mo for what we've been able to do in a relatively short period of 1 year. I'm delighted to be here in Alexandria and to be in this great library. And this morning we had the chance to visit it briefly. The director, Ismail, took us around. And it is an exciting place. And when you visit a place like this, you sometimes wish you were a young student and you can spend lots of your time in a place like this to be inspired. Today we hope will be a day of celebration, and that we will all be here to celebrate an African achievement and an African leader who has done a lot for his country, as you heard from Mo. And I hope tonight we can all let our hair down and relax a little bit. I should be careful, because whenever I say I'm going to let my hair down, my wife looks at my head and said that would be a challenge. But we're going to try. So I think let's make it fun and let's celebrate our continent. And we hope to see most of you tonight. Now let's take your questions. And let me introduce, I think you did it brilliantly. To my left is Salim Ahmed Salim, who really doesn't need any introduction. And most of you had known him as the great Secretary General of the Organization of African Unity, who had also served his country as Prime Minister and served in many other capacities, putting Africa on the map. Next to him is Mary Robinson, a great internationalist, a former President of Ireland, who also served as High Commissioner for Human Rights, and has not stopped serving the world since she stepped down as High Commissioner. I think she's busier than ever pushing the issue of human rights and gender empowerment. And next to her is Aisha Badialo, who as a minister in her own country served the country well, but has also been very active on the international scene. Next is Marty Atesari, another great friend, whom, as you know, was one of the people who played a key role in the independence of Namibia. He was the representative of the Secretary General and really made a great difference. He later became the president of Finland and served that country brilliantly. And last and finally is Ngozi, who was a brilliant finance minister of Nigeria, a former World Bank official, and now they have tempted her to go back to help at the bank. So she's returning to the bank that she left some years ago as managing director of the World Bank, and I'm sure from there she will continue her work for Africa and for the world. So the ladies and gentlemen, these are the brilliant men and women who helped me in running this prize committee, and I hope we gave you a worthy winner. The floor is open for questions.
سامي فعلا صحفي في الأهرام ومدير مكتب المصري اليوم بالإسكندرية. لدي سؤالين خاصين بالسيد كوفي أنان. أولاهم
I'm not sure the translation is coming.
Okay. اوكي سامي خير الله صحفي في الاهرام ومدير مكتب المصري اليوم بالاسكندريه. لدي سؤالين خاصين بالسيد كوفي انان. اولاهم نريد معرفه وجهه نظر السيد كوفي انان الدوليه حول مدى نجاح مؤتمر السلام الدولي الذي سيعقد في انابوليس، وهل تتوقع ان يخرج المؤتمر بصيغه نهائيه؟
Ask you to repeat it very briefly, just a bit.
نريد معرفة وجهة نظر السيد كوفي أنان الدولية حول مدى نجاح مؤتمر السلام الدولي الذي سيعقد في أنابوليس، وهل تتوقع أن يخرج المؤتمر بصيغة نهائية حول الحل الشامل والعادل للقضية الفلسطينية وإنهاء الصراع الدائر مع الجانب الإسرائيلي؟ أما السؤال الثاني، هل يسعى السيد كوفي أنان أن يجعل من مكتبة الأسكندرية كمقر دائم لجائزة مؤسسة مو إبراهيم الدولية للحكم الرشيد، وتعلن الجوائز الخاصة بالمؤسسة من خلال المكتبة، خاصة وأن المكتبة تقع في قلب القارة السمراء؟ شكرا.
Let me say that I'm sure all of us here are very interested in the Annapolis meeting, but I'll come back to that. For the first phase of the press conference, I would want us to focus on the Mo Ibrahim Prize, and then when we have time, I'll come back to other questions, including the one you have raised. But as I said, we are extremely happy to be here at the Alexandra Library, and I think we're going to have a great event tonight. And as Mo said, this is something that a library that is of great importance to Africa and to the world, and we are really very happy to be able to have this facility for the event that we are organizing today. So let me take the other questions and I'll come back to the Palestinian issue later. But questions on the Mo Ibrahim Prize at this stage. Yes, the gentleman.
Thank you. I'm asking about some sources speaks about the limitation of this prize, which it should be contained the president who left the regime for 4 or 5 years. This is the first question. There is a limitation for this prize. We might not find sufficient leaders to have this prize in Africa. The other question is about the, I'm asking if there is connection between the index, Ibrahim Index, and the criteria of having a prize for African presidents. Because if we look to the index, we can find that states which has a lower grades. That means the prize will be on the top level of this index, or it might be from the bottom, I don't know. My last question, I'm asking...
If I may ask everyone to ask one question.
Okay,
there are so many journalists here, let's be fair to them. Thank you very much. Let me say that on your first question, since this was the first year we are offering the prize, we did take the crop of leaders who have left office during the last 3-4 years to look at them for this year's award. Moving forward, we would be looking at leaders who have stepped down, and for example, if we go into next year, we'll be looking at leaders who are not in office, who have stepped down, but have contributed to the work of their country. We also reserve the right that we may not give a prize every year. If we have if we review the leaders who are out of office and they meet the criteria and we think there's a deserving winner, we will offer the prize. But if we come to the conclusion that no one deserves it, we don't have to give a prize. But I would also say on the criteria, we used, the index was one of the elements that went into the decision and the judgment. There were other factors that went in. You know, we also assessed what the individual had done beyond his own country, particularly since they stepped down, and how they are seen around the world and on the continent. So we used our own individual knowledge and wisdom. We looked at the other information we had gathered, as well as the index. And so it was a whole element of factors that went into the decision. It wasn't a straightforward mathematical decision. Yes. And so this is what I wanted you to know. I think Mo wants to add something.
Yeah, just allow me to add one or two remarks. I think the question I heard quite frequently on the European continent and America was, will you find enough presidents who qualify? And I'm astonished that the question is still asked, same question here in Africa. We need to get out of that mood, that way of thinking. Unfortunately, there is a focus, the media are really focusing on our bad boys. If we have one or two or three or four bad boys, that is the focus. That's what we see day in and out on CNN and BBC and everywhere. Africa has 53 countries. Africa produced, not my words, Gordon Brown, the Prime Minister of UK. 2 months ago, he erected a statue, Britain erected a statue for Nelson Mandela in front of the House of Parliament. And Gordon Brown stood there to say, Africa produced the greatest leader of the world in the 20th century. The greatest leader in the 20th century is an African man. I think it's time for us Africans to feel a little bit proud. The problem is our good leaders, nobody knows about them. How many of you heard about Chissano before we announced his winning? I bet half of you don't know who Chissano is. It is time for us Africans to wake up and to dictate our own agenda and to run our own show. There's a lot of decent, good African leaders. We need to encourage those people and to support them to move forward. There are few bad people, and we're giving the society the means to handle with them. As for the index, actually, the leader, the people who are leading countries at the bottom of the index have the greatest chance to win. Why? Because winning the prize is about moving. We look at the index in its dynamics, year on year. So if you're leading a country in the bottom of the index, you have an easier task to take it forward. Rwanda moved 19 places in 5 years. Doesn't make Rwanda the best African governed country, but it moved forward 19 places by just stopping the civil war. So people who can take action and move their countries forward can really have a better, much better chart, much easier chart to win than somebody running a country at the top, because how much can you move a country at the top? So we look at the dynamics of the table, okay? Thank you.
Next question.
Yeah, I'm Kayo De Komolafe. I represent These Day newspapers from Nigeria. My question goes to Dr. Ibrahim. I'm just puzzled why you're focusing on what you call the sub-Saharan Africa. Is leadership not a question for the whole of Africa? Why limiting your assessment to sub-Saharan Africa? Thank you.
Really, sub-Saharan Africa means 48 countries out of the 53. So this is like 90% of Africa we're looking at. In fairness, we think the set of challenges faced by sub-Saharan country are distinctly different from the set of challenges facing the northern countries. I am a businessman. Investors in Europe, in the US, etc., have no problem investing money in Morocco, in Tunisia, in Egypt, because they think of these countries as south of the Mediterranean. Okay? But when they come to Sub-Sahara, they say, oh, this is Africa. So there's different sets of challenges, different set of issues concerning AIDS, malaria, etc. But there's another consideration. This foundation is funded completely by the money we made as a businessman doing business in Sub-Sahara Africa. So it's logical that I give the money back to where the money was, to the country was made. That's why we're starting with Sub-Sahara Africa.
Ngozi, you want to add a word?
I think in addition to that, what you have to think about is also the positive message that is going out. The continent is changing. Sub-Saharan Africa is performing better in terms of its governance and even, you know, economic management. And the idea that you focus attention on this by also awarding a prize to a leader who is leading their country in a good way, I think is a positive thing.
And I would hope that each year when this award is given, that the population and civil society around the continent will use it as occasion to debate and discuss issues of governance. To pose the question, what did this leader do to win? What are we doing wrong in my country or that country? How can we improve and place ourselves in situation that next year it will be our turn or the year after?
I thank you, Secretary General Kofi Annan. I'm a choir from Tanzania. First of all, I think really Dr. Mo Ibrahim has to be commended to have the equivalent of our own Nobel Peace Prize here. I mean, we in Africa, we have our own equivalent. But my question really here is that, Dr. Ibrahim, don't you think that the resource that you have concentrated on the reward, the prize, could be spread to recognize people who have, African people, who have done very well, who have distinguished themselves well in medicine, in science, in the media? No, this is my question. Thank you, Dr. Kofi Annan.
You are absolutely right. There are a lot of wonderful people in Africa doing wonderful things who are not really rewarded. Unfortunately, I have to remember that I'm only one individual, and I have given all my money to this foundation. I wish I had more money to start this. And I invite here other African business people and, you know, you guys, you do something. You start with something. You don't expect me to do everything, okay? I'm doing what I can. But I'm starting then with where it counts, where it hurts. The buck stops here. And we calling the shots on the president because they are responsible.
Mary, you want to add something?
As a human rights person, I particularly value the focus on leadership and the broad way in which both the index and the other ways can measure, because I think it's very good to have within the continent a way to talk about leadership that isn't coming somehow from outside and being judged from outside. And the foundation is supporting other ways of assessing leadership. We have linked with the African Monitor, which is led by the current Archbishop of Cape Town, and that is a bottom-up, grassroots way of assessing leadership. So we want to improve the tools for that assessment. I think that's one of the great strengths of both the prize and the index and this focus on governance, which is really what we want to concentrate on. Other leadership deserves to be recognized also, but our particular focus is on political leadership of a country.
Yes, let me go to the right.
My name is Kwanele Sosibam from the Mail and Guardian in South Africa. My question to you, Dr. Ibrahim, is why are we rewarding African leaders for doing something that should come naturally? I don't think that we should have an incentive system for good leadership. Good leadership should be something that is par for the course, even in Africa.
That, I think, is a good question. We need to stop and think about it, because I heard that question a number of times in South Africa, particularly in South Africa. I don't think good leadership and the hard decisions has to be made do come naturally. You don't. If you do, why are we starting this thing about governance? Why Africa really needs to look after the issue of leadership and governance? Unfortunately, it doesn't. The second point I wish to make here is that it is also very natural for us to honor distinction. We're not honoring people for doing their jobs. We're honoring people for excelling in doing their jobs. Like Nobel Prize, why do we have a Nobel Prize? It's for people who excelled in doing. Don't you think the professors who win Nobel Prize for chemistry or for physics are obeyed very well? I assure you, my friend, they obeyed very well. Why do we have the Olympics? Why do we have to honor the fastest, the highest, the strongest? Why are you going to have the football competition in your country, my friend, in a few years' time? Why are you going to have the World Cup in your country? Why are you going to honor the winner of that cup? Everybody wants to honor. We always want to honor the best. And we are looking for the best that Africa can offer and want to honor those people. But guess what? Those people taking millions of people out of poverty. Those people are stopping wars, are stopping strife, taking hard decisions, implementing democratic changes, and stepping down in office on time. These are people need to be honored, and we will continue to honor those people.
Sir, do you think that more current African leaders need to step down from office now, and which leaders in particular do you hope your award will encourage to step down?
I don't think this is intended as an alternative for free election of leaders by the people. But we would hope that the discussion about governance, about leadership, would also inform the way people use their votes. We are not intending to influence elections, but I think the discussions will help enlighten the voters. I think we have to accept no one is born a good Democrat. No one is born a Democrat. No one is born a good citizen. We all have to learn, and it's hard, hard work. And I think this process is part of that effort.
Adil Ilbaz from Sudan. هل تتوقعون سيد محمد هل تتوقعون أن تثمر هذه الجائزة وتنعكس على حياة الشعوب الأفريقية غريبا أم أنها تحتاج إلى أجيال؟ السؤال الثاني، هل يمكن المشاركة في الجائزة يعني يفوز الرئيسان إذا بقينا محظوظين بجائزة واحدة؟ شكرا. السؤال الأول متعلق هل تتوقعون أن تأتي هذه الجائزة أو تأتي أكلها غريبا أم تحتاج إلى أجيال؟
I said one question.
The other is for you.
I don't think Rome was built in a day. We are part of that great effort of this mass movement called civil society. And like water, we are chipping at Xerox. You know, it's going to take years for the full impact of this price to take. But we are there, and we'll keep doing it. We'll be here, inshallah, 20 years' time. We'll be here. We'll be doing it. And you'll see the change then.
Can be shared? Yes.
It is possible that in a particular year, more than one person would win the prize. And as you know, it happens with other prizes. You've seen it with Nobel Peace Prizes, where sometimes you have more than one winner. And so I don't think the committee would exclude that. Let me ask for the last question, and then I'll come back to you. One last question. Madam.
Mona Swilam, Nile TV International Egyptian Television. Between 1990 and 2005, Africa lost approximately $300 billion through armed conflict, and that was equal to the amount of money Africa received in humanitarian aid from major donors in the same period. Would you ever consider a prize for bad governance?
Well, a prize for bad governance and a prize for good governance is both the other side of the same coin. By honoring an achievement of a brilliant leader and a good leader, you are in a way encouraging people to do whatever they can to get out of bad governance. And in fact, I think the issue you've raised is a real issue. Not only is it a real issue, this continent has suffered quite a lot through conflicts, unnecessary conflicts that has taken place on this continent. Although things are improving, I think Mo did say that Africa is changing. In 1997, there were 41 armed conflicts, civil conflicts. Today, there are 31. Quite a lot of the conflicts which have been resolved were on the African continent, from Sierra Leone to Burundi, even Rwanda that went through that genocide is stabilized. You have a similar situation in Liberia, and Democratic Republic of Congo went through its first elections in 45 years. So things are happening. But there are serious issues of governance that we must tackle. And we hope this prize is highlighting the importance of governance, that it is a key factor if this continent is going to move forward. So in a way, we are on the same wavelength. Whatever method you use, if you go the positive route by rewarding excellence and good governance, or you go the other way, fingering bad governance, we are on the same wavelength.
Two remarks. President, in the citation for the prize, what the committee told us, I'm not a member of the committee, one of the reasons for choosing President Chissano, because he's a leader who has the moral courage to stop civil war in his country, to shake hands with his enemies, bring them into the democratic process in his country, and transform the country into democracy. So by honoring a man like that, I think we're exporting this. If you look at our index, which we produce, and I encourage everybody to visit our site, which is moibrahimfoundation.org, and it's in Arabic, in English, in French, in Swahili, and Portuguese. You will see that the countries which came at the bottom of the table, there's one common thing among them, all have internal conflicts. Nothing like internal conflicts destroys bad governance. This says everything. Health, education, jobs, it just destroys. Okay? So we are the same over there.
Thank you very much. I did promise to come back to your question on the Palestinian and the Israeli peace talks in Annapolis. I cannot tell you that there will be an agreed document in Annapolis. I know that the parties have been working over the months, and Prime Minister, President Abbas and Prime Minister Olmert had met many times, and their teams have been working. What I would say is that an attempt to relaunch the peace talks or the peace process is long overdue. It's long overdue because we see the problems and the tensions on the ground day in and day out and over the years. I hope the parties are going to Annapolis determined to make progress and to make a difference. I hope they will be able to take the essential steps necessary to keep the process alive. I hope there will be an indication of some time frame within which some progress can be made. And whatever is agreed to, I hope, would also be monitored for implementation. As someone who was a member of the quartet that came up with the roadmap, it didn't succeed. And I think one of the weaknesses of the roadmap was the fact that we did not have a monitoring mechanism. I wish those participating in the meeting in Annapolis all success. It takes courage to make peace. It takes courage to bring protagonists together. There are always risks that it may not work, but that is no reason why one should not try. And so I urge them good luck, success, patience, and determination. Thank you.
This is just a short announcement. I had a message from the floor that people apologize. The version of the film was shown before the conference was the English version. They have an Arabic version which will be shown at the end of the conference. So if you are Arabic speaking, we apologize to you. There will be an Arabic version shown after this if you want to stay behind and watch it. And thank you very much for your time.